Hi there. This video is about literary criticism analysis and things or some general tips in order to help you write a dissertation in a good way to do. So first thing to do or to know is make a difference between literary analysis, dissertation, and critical literature analysis or critical analysis or critical literature analysis or essay. So there is a difference between the two dissertations. In literary analysis dissertation, you are just asked to write, to focus on the main parts in the text, in the book, in the piece of literature you have selected, and then connect between the plot, characters, the events, give a general idea about point of view, language, the tone, and a conclusion. But in critical literature essay, it's a little bit, say, let's call it more professional. In a literary critical analysis, you have to provide literary analysis plus criticism, plus criticism that should be backed up by a critical scholarship. What critics said about the book you have selected, plus of course your own synopsis or summary, your own style to avoid plagiarism. So let's do it. The first thing to do is to know what are the literary techniques and the literary devices used by the author. This is a literary analysis. What is plus in the literary critical analysis is to give us the targets, the objective for which those literary techniques have been used by the author. So let's start. Literary devices are many, or techniques. Let me give just examples and show you how to use them in order to analyze in a body of a dissertation. You can have devices related to language, like diction. So all that is diction is related to the style, the language used. You can focus here the stylistic approach in order to deal with the punctuation, the grammatical use of sentences, topic sentences, relevant, irrelevant in terms of context, background, culture. So, but all your worry, all your focus rather is on the words and the way it is used by the author. You can, with language devices, you can also speak about figures of speech. Most famous ones used by the novelists or poems, poets are usually alliteration, the repetition of the same letter between two words. And generally, the writer used alliteration in order to focus on the memory of the reader or the audience, in order to make you remember a thing. He uses alliteration for that. Like titles, usually we find this in titles of novels. Nicola Nickleby by Charles Dickens. Pickwick Papers by the same writer, Charles Dickens. Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens. Fitzgerald's famous Great Gatsby, same letter repeated. Some said that even Bernard Shaw, Caesar and Cleopatra, it's not the same word, same sound, sorry, but in the same letter, Caesar and Cleopatra are considered as alliteration titles by novelists. So this is as far as alliteration is concerned. You can find also another figure of speech called allegory. Allegory is the use of strong symbolism, strong imagination, and you can add within it allusion. It means that the writer uses an event in fictional world to mean it and refer it in real life, or use allegory, for example, Animal Farm. Is the whole novel is an allegory, allegorical novel. The use of animals, but meaning people in real life. Like if you say old major is referred to Napoleon. Also Stalin is referred in the novel. The pig in the farm, the owner of the farm, is in parallel with Napoleon, and of course meaning dictatorship. Or the Russian regime, as far as Animal Farm Orwell's view is concerned. You can also find, we have allegory, you can also find personification, so the use of non-objects or animals that are attributed to human qualities and use them as in a figurative sense to mean real life. You can focus figurative language, but also you can focus non-literal imaginative language like colloquialisms, dialects words, slang expressions, street words. For example, instead of finding going to, you find gonna. Instead of the writer used the, you know, that to say the best, he said da bomb to mean the best. Over there, he says over yonder. For example, to mean sadness and melancholy, instead of saying be sad, he said be blue, to mean sadness. So these are colloquialisms that are normally famous in the community concerned, in the sample population of that dialect speaker. And what is difficult in colloquialisms, a non-native reader may find difficulty in order to detect, unless the use of a dialect dictionary can help solve the matter. You have also, this is as far as literary devices related to language. You can find literary devices related to the plot, to the scenery, to the way events are connected, like the use of flashbacks and foreshadowings. Flashbacks versus foreshadowings. A flashback, of course, is the impact of the influence of the past on the present. Chapter 1 you find on the last night, and chapter 2 you find 2 years ago, and so on. So you are transported to the past in order to re-explain the present. While the foreshadowing is the use of some clues by the novelist or the poet in order to mean what should happen in the future. So that is the difference between both. Symbolism and imagery is an excellent, of course, literary device to mean, used by the writer to mean or insinuate, refer, allude things in real life. Like the use of the fog in Bleak House. Exceptional is Charles Dickens in all his novels, particularly in Bleak House. The description of great professionalism and wittism, with so witty in the use of the description of the fog. He says fog in the fog everywhere, fog up the river, fog down the river, and fog in the Chancery Court. He means that wherever you go, you find dictators, oppressors. So he meant depression and oppression everywhere. Then he said fog cruelly, pinching the toes and fingers. So in real life, physically, yes, indeed, the fog, especially if you aren't accustomed to a November weather in London, so you are pinched by the fog. But he meant the effects and the drawbacks of oppression of the high class, the upper class, the rich men, on the poor people in England. That's the meaning, or the use of symbolism, fog as a symbol to mean other phenomena, many oppression, dictatorship, depression of a upper class vis-a-vis the working class. Other literary devices can be euphemism. The use of euphemisms, usually people understand euphemism for something sexual, and it's not the case. Euphemism can refer to anything, okay, sexual or impolite or unpleasant. So these are euphemisms used by the writer to go to scenes, words, or people like that. You can use characters, the characterization elements in the analysis of the novel, and back up your ideas or your penchants towards the matter by critics and what did they say. Fry is an excellent critic, Todorov is an excellent critic, Tolstoy, in ancient time Henry Fielding for satire. You can find Nabokov, excellent excellent writers, excellent book lectures on literature. His own notes, his own lecturing in colleges are reported in his book entitled Lectures in Literature. And if you are interested in sentimental novels and so on, you can find a detailed critique of Nabokov to Jane Austen's Mansfield Park, and you can find also an excellent critique by Nabokov to Bleak House, plus other books like Madame Bovary and so on. This is for the main important critics, like T.C. Eliot also can be a good critic to back up your data. Hélène Showalter, of course, is an excellent writer centering the woman approach in order to analyze women literature in general. Virginia Woolf also can be good, and other critics of your own choice, your own selection, picking up of the novel or the poem or the play you choose, plus the approach suitable. We have, for example, the sentimentalist approach for sentimental novels, focusing especially on the feeling, on the emotion. You have the biographical approach, to which extent the life of the author and the circumstances around him affect the literary work, the description of the people, and so on. The psychological approach is a recent one, and the most recent one, the one which can make an excellent dissertation of criticism, is the neo-historicism plus the discourse analysis. So you can focus historical, socio-political background in the novel, but not remain in the past, relate such historical events with real life, and at the same time study the discourse, the dialogue, the phrases, the wording or the words in the novel. It can make a good analysis, but for shorter dissertation, I suggest one approach is enough to provide a short literary critical analysis or dissertation. Unless you want to provide details, pay attention, you have to be to master language, must avoid gossips, be terse, be direct to the subject, and provide arguments, 4 to 5 arguments to back up your data, less if the dissertation is short. So let me recapitulate things. You have to know literary techniques and devices used by the writer in order to provide to write his work first, then choose, select one of these devices and back up with critical scholarship your point of view or your opinion, your understanding, your own interpretation to the work. As far as the dissertation way to write, you provide 3 parts. Bear in mind, you have introduction, body parts, conclusion. Introduction, body, and conclusion. Both introduction and conclusion should be written in a perfect way. You have to try to make it perfect, attractive, talented, and creative. For the introduction and the conclusion, what should they contain? First, the introduction should contain the author, title, few central ideas about the book selected. Then start in the second sentence or the third, the thesis statement. What's your thesis statement? The focus you've been attracted towards in order to defend your dissertation. Now you go to the body. Here the body is the defensive parts, where you provide arguments from critics about an image use, imagery or symbolism, as I said, or character, or for example, parallelism, like I said, old major in Animal Farm is compared to Napoleon or Stalin, for example. You can take, for example, the blonde in the blonde character. Many writers use it, for example, Oates, Joyce Carol Oates, used the blonde novel to mean Marilyn Monroe, for example. The Russian one meant Kutuzov, general. Dumas for Richelieu, or Shakespeare for Tudor propaganda, or Shakespeare's Henry VI to mean one of the presidents of America of today. So this is a new historicism to reread or revisit the work and link that historical event or that historical character within today, today's real person in life. So this is for the body, the introduction. I said title, writer, a few summary of the main central ideas, and start your thesis statement. Prepare for it for the body. In the body part, you have to be objective, central, direct. Don't gossip, don't provide details. Go to defend the idea by others, scholars' views. through via language or characterization or the plot or whatever you choose, up to the approach chosen and the novel picks up, or the poem or the play, and back up by evidence. Evidence should be both arguments from primary source, which is the novel selected, the piece of literature selected. I also allow, if you like, non-fiction sources, so biographies, diaries, and so on, translated work, or novel, novellas, short stories, plays, or poems. So you select one out of these pieces of literature, and you back up in the body. Pay attention, your work should be centered around evidence from the main source, which is the book selected, and arguments from critical scholarship to back up an idea about an imagery, an image, a figurative language, a character, a plot event, like the plot for speculative fiction known by Agatha Christie in detective novels. Historical novels go very nice, of course, with new historicism. The sentimental, with the sentimental novels. By the conclusion, back to talented writing, you have to conclude by two sentences. If the dissertation is short, more two sentences can be two paragraphs in longer dissertation. But for short dissertation, for example, in an exam, you can provide two sentences concluding by it your analysis, reminding or summarizing very quickly the main important thesis statements, and summary of the statement, summary of the arguments, and conclude by an opinion that's preferably not to be yours, because it should allude to subjectivity. You have to be objective, remember that. So you have to provide others' opinion that you, inside your own literary penchant, you agree with that critic or the other. Praising the novel, hating the novel, criticizing the novel, appreciating it or not, it's not your job. It's your job to give us data and backup argue by arguments and evidence. So this is all in all how to write, very briefly, how to write a critical dissertation analysis in few lines, or few general tips. So all in all, as a summary, we can say that a critical analysis is should be talented, professional, using argument in order to back up your evidence, using a short idea in the beginning with title of the author and the book, then a small synopsis in the body part within evidence and arguments for backing up your data, then conclude by two sentences summarizing the overall analysis. Thank you very much.